actually reading from the next novel I'm working on. It's called Viridian. The first part is cyanotic. I doubt I ever made a commitment to this world. Born blue, I was called cyanotic, and my mother was told by the nuns in the Catholic hospital in Boston, perhaps our Lord wants her more than you do. Because she was postpartum and a woman, and because it was 1959, she feared the nuns were right. They were wrong, and so began my constant give and take with various deities, bargaining with permanence or evanescence. My parts continued to be consecrated to specific needs and betrayals. These are the wars and pacts that I have spanned. Yesterday I watched on a screen a scope go down my bronchial tube. The red flesh pulsed and white spots slipped from the sides of the flesh walls. I coughed hard, my whole chest heaving forward, pulling me off the table. I heard the doctor tell the nurse to give me more cc's of something. A warmth seeped through my veins. I still spasmed forward, but I wasn't hurting. My lungs have filled with color, not pink or red, not even blood-colored, but a pulsing rose. 2, anarchy replaced by description. I lived with a man once who could talk a storm of color, and he could do it in more than one language. Sebastian, or Sebas, as his dear ones called him, was a set designer. He was Spanish, he was enchanting, he just seemed European. He could dress well and comb his hair well and kiss men and women on both cheeks and gesticulate and still pass for hetero. Mm-hmm. I was still closeted, so we covered for each other when we needed to, like with parents. One of the things I loved most about Sebas was his library. Oversized books bound in ropey canvas with deep imprinted titles, monographs sewed in leather with signets of Italian presses stamped in gold on the frontispiece. Texts of period costumes etched in pen and ink, separated by a leaf of rice paper. My favorite, a small red paper book with a glued spine, with a simple circle dissected by a line on the cover. A color notation by A.H. Munsell. Munsell invented the color wheel. He lived in the mid-1800s and died before his time, exhausted in the early 1900s. Purportedly because of too much lecturing abroad on his chroma and hue theories. Excuse me. The first time I found this book of Sebas's, we were startlingly high on hashish. We were in our apartment, a loft on Broome Street, reachable only by a service elevator. It was the 80s, a time when lofts were available and still almost rustic. The sun was low, but the sky was still light enough for me to read Munsell's statement, color anarchy is replaced by color description. Something here wanted to categorize loveliness, rein in glory with precision. Quote, rational color nomenclature also arrived in this section. At night, we lay on our backs and stared at the dark green swirls and edges in the chrome of the tin press ceiling. Once, Sebas surprised me by tracing the patterns in some Day-Glo paint and then adding stars and moons and comets. We had a fire escape too, and it was wider than most. I remember a dress that I had, so wide and full that it seemed to have been made of a spinnaker. It was the softest green, a seafoam married to pearl. We would bring pillows to sit on the wrought metal steps and look over the cobbled streets of quiet downtown, drinking San Miguel and listening to Michelle Schacht and Mano Cho on a boombox. Once I found a square hardcover no bigger than my palm, The Book of Blue. It included triangular glossy samples by its definitions. Cerulean, the one they used for sky, and viridian, a low intensity broken color, a greenish turquoise. Maya, which is soft and light. The three together presented a travelogue, although I didn't know who they were using the colors. Painters, brochure makers. Regardless, I would go there, I hoped, to the easing place where the turquoise, though broken, warmed in the soft, light air under the cerulean of it all. Thank you.